It measures 14 feet 3 inches long by 3 feet 7 inches wide, which includes a hand-sewn seam added at an unknown date. These full-length dark lines are scorches from the fire that nearly destroyed it in 1532. The diamond-shaped patches cover holes resulting from that fire.
The modern investigation and controversy over the Shroud began in 1898.
A gifted amateur Italian photographer, Secondo Pia, was allowed unprecedented permission by the King of Italy to take the first photograph of the Shroud. When it was spread out for display, Pia was disappointed on seeing that the image on the cloth was extremely faint. But what he caught on his two glass photographic plates stunned the world. It showed that the image on the cloth itself was photographically negative. Consequently, the faint, almost ghost-like images on the shroud appeared in reverse on his camera plates, making them a positive image. It was the first time in history that the likeness could be seen in full, majestic detail.
The best scientists in the world have observed this image, measured, studied it, and still have no explanation for how the image was formed.
I feel that the radiation that made the image was a direct result of the resurrection.
It's basically some form of natural phenomenon, or some people might say supernatural phenomenon.
Skeptics are completely wrong in insisting that the trail of the Shroud goes back only to the middle 1300s. It does, in fact, go back to the Bible itself. The 20th chapter of the Gospel of John, verse 6, states that when Peter entered the tomb of Jesus on Sunday morning, he found the shroud. Now, normally a grave cloth would be considered unclean and not saved. But if it bore the image of the body it had contained, this would explain why it was retrieved by Jesus' followers and treated with great reverence.
The reputed Bishop Darcy letter has never been proved genuine. None of the copies of the Darcy letter that we have is signed or dated. There's also no proof that the Pope ever saw it or that it was even delivered to him. And besides, no trace or hint of identity has ever been found of the artist, who, if he ever made the image on the shroud, would have belonged among the ranks of Michelangelo, Da Vinci, and Raphael.
The image on the Shroud of Turin is negative, meaning that the lights and darks are reversed from the way we would normally see with our eyes. Assuming that the shroud were manufactured in the 14th century, it would mean someone would have had to have conceived of the concept of photography approximately 650 years before it was invented. I don't think so.
In 1973, the shroud was brought out for a brief examination by a group of European scientists. Among them was the late Dr. Max Frey, a Swiss criminologist and one of the leading experts in dust and pollen analysis in the world. Dr. Frey almost single-handedly developed a technique to determine where criminals had been by testing samples of dust and pollen from their clothing. At first, Dr. Frey's objective was simple. If the shroud was forged in France in the 14th century, then only the French or Italian pollens would be found in the cloth. But his exhaustive analysis found some 58 specific pollens, only 17 of which were indigenous to Europe. The rest were from Palestine and southern Turkey, the site of Edessa and Constantinople. And this meant that the shroud had been in these places at some time in its history. It has been alleged that the type of linen, the herringbone pattern weave, was very rare in the Palestine area, but that it was a very common textile after the 12th century in Europe. This is simply not true. Neither the linen nor the weave were common in Europe. This same pattern is identical to mummy wrappings that go back as far as 2000 BC. Joseph of Arimathea was a wealthy man who received permission from Pilate to bury Christ's body. It is not unlikely that when he gave his tomb for the burial of Christ, he may have also used expensive Middle Eastern linen grave clothes that were intended for his own burial.
Whatever the mechanism for forming the image on the shroud, it had to occur in a short period of time, act in an up and down direction, and produce an image intensity determined by the distance between the cloth and the body. One of the theories which seems to satisfy these characteristics is a coronal discharge similar to Curlian photography or lightning.
One scientist said it's like every pore of the body suddenly fired a miniature laser beam for a split second of time. And so I'm sure that there's some power, some explanation that defies our current understanding.
And I believe that when the body of Christ was raised to that multi-dimension that scientists call in space, that there was a little extra burst of radiation that marked the shroud.
2,000 years ago, the Romans used crucifixion as the most humiliating form of execution. The victim was first tortured and then either tied or nailed to a wooden cross. The image on the shroud appears to have multiple lacerations.
Scourging was usually done as a prelude to crucifixion. Generally, they only scourged them a few times prior to it because they didn't want them to die beforehand. What they would do is they would take an instrument called a flagrum, which had leather thongs on it, usually three, with bits of metal or bone at the end. The metal would penetrate the flesh, ripping nerves, blood vessels, and so forth. Generally, the individuals would go into absolute agony, some of them actually to the point of convulsions. The Shroud of Turin shows over 100 markings from these patterned injuries.
The most dramatic marks on the image indicate that the man was then nailed to a cross.
The Shroud of Turin shows the wound in the wrist area on the back of the hand. If the nail went through here, at the base of the thumb region here, it would emerge exactly where the Shroud of Turin shows it and would be in an extremely firm place that would hold several hundred pounds.
You can find examples in Masada of this kind of seam. All what we see in this aspect shows us that it was a precious piece.
With the shroud having been sewn in the same distinctive style as the first century Masada cloths, Fleury Lemberg believes it could not be a medieval forgery.
The Masada cloth is seven after Christ, where we can show this special seam, but it is the system of sewing which it can show. It's not to compare with this piece, of course, but the system of sewing was known. I don't believe in this carbon 14 dating, especially because we have so many signs that this piece of linen is done in the first century.
The entire process was videotaped, and I'm certainly the only person on this planet who watched every frame of the whole 8-hour procedure. It's all wonderfully documented, except for a missing half hour.
It turns out that the cameras were turned off when the shroud pieces were taken to another room and put into three containers, one for each lab.
My question, of course, was since they were documenting everything, why wasn't this part documented? It was, after all, the critical moment.
The reason given for turning off the cameras? So that the labs wouldn't be able to tell the shroud piece from the control samples. But the labs already knew which piece belonged to the shroud, because it was never dethreaded. And Kirsten's conclusion?
Well, in reality, some kind of manipulations must have taken place in there.
By carefully examining the photos of the shroud pieces and the ones the lab received, Kirsten has deduced that a switch must have taken place. According to him, the samples don't match, either by weight or appearance.
This piece shows the Oxford sample, which was used to perform the radiocarbon dating. We can identify the fold axis, and we have the zero thread, at which point the weaving pattern turns in a different direction. This coordinate system allows us to compare the pieces like fingerprints. This one is not identical to this one. Here we can see the bleeding from the wound in the side, the famous side wound which Longinus made with his spear. Here we can clearly see the strong flows of blood after the body was laid in the horizontal position.
And Kirsten thinks those blood flows are a telltale forensic sign.